the factory fad that's got tourists talking here in Japan.
But is seeing smokestacks, pipes, and industrial landscapes your idea of a good night out? Coming up on this week's program, I climb aboard a voyage of discovery to find out why on-trend travellers in Japan are taking a trip most tourists would try to avoid. We travel to Estonia to join a trek to the Baltic backwards on the outlook for brown bears.
Once I'm in here, we're not going to leave until tomorrow morning until we've seen some bears.
We meet the people who make London's hidden waterway work.
When you're telling people about something that you love yourself and you're passionate about, what's not to like?
Michelle Yana-Chan has your global guide with some of the best places to visit from around the world, including jousting and sword fighting at a medieval festival in Denmark. And there's news of an upcoming surfing extravaganza in Australia.
Hello and welcome to The Travel Show, coming to you this week from Japan. Now, most visitors here will tick off the usual sights and tours, a traditional shrine, a visit to the shopping districts of Tokyo, and the obligatory ride on a bullet train. But in the home of quirky fads and weird trends, a rather offbeat type of tour is gaining popularity. Industrial tourism.
Kojo Moe, in Japanese, literally translates to factory infatuation, and it refers to the growing popularity of bleak industrial areas as tourist attractions. Kojo Moe tours are different to the traditional factory tours that take you inside a plant. Instead, these trips take people around industrial compounds and areas to admire their eerie science fiction-like quality, especially at night. Keen to experience the atmosphere myself, I decided to book on a factory night view tour just south of Tokyo.
So this isn't how I would ordinarily spend my Saturday night, going on a factory tour in Kawasaki. And I must admit, I thought I would be the only other person on this tour, but I've been told there are at least 40 others. Here goes.
There are various bus tours, but we've booked on a boat tour of the industrial zone that spreads along the Tokyo Bay. Our tour guide tells us this isn't Disneyland, so don't expect bright neon lights. Many people will bring their dinner or some snacks and make an evening of it, enjoying the reflections of factory lights on the dark waters.
This isn't your average boat tour. I can smell the salty air, but it's also mixed in with smoke and oil and gasoline smells. I've been told it's great for taking photographs. I've brought my camera, but I don't really seem to be doing it justice.
But for many Kojo Moe enthusiasts, photography is the main draw. And from these pictures, it's easy to see why.
It's difficult to shoot still photos, but I feel that the orange flares, the beautiful orange lights, are nice, and just by looking at them, we're away from our daily lives and routines.
I'm sure most people like ordinary night views, but some feel that some things people generally don't like could be really cool.
For many of the people here, bleakness is a big draw, but the movement does have its detractors. But tourism officials are making the most of this factory fascination and taking it to the mainstream.
I think many corporations want their consumers or the general public to understand what they are actually doing. Mm-hmm. So it's a kind of company's corporate image strategy. Because if consumers like the image of the factory or the product, then they may buy their stocks or they may buy the product.
On the other end of the spectrum of factory tourism is this celebration of instant noodles, the Cup Noodle Museum in Yokohama. Here you can make your own cup noodles with more than 5,000 flavour combinations. Let's give it a try.
This is really slimy. Wow, look how long it is.
And while this isn't everybody's idea of a holiday, the popularity of factory sightseeing tours has caught the attention of the national government. It's claimed campaigners are even proposing a change in the law so working factories can qualify for World Heritage status.
Wow!
Either way, these tours are certainly off the beaten track and are capturing another facet of Japanese culture.
So if noodle making factories aren't your thing, there are plenty of other tours to be had here in Japan. You could find out where the snow blowers at Santa Claus's village in Finland are made at the Fuji factory, or why not check out what's making the cogs in your watch move at Seiko Epson. But of course, Japan isn't the only country promoting industrial tourism. So here's the travel show roundup of some of the more interesting factory tours around the world.
In the American city of Detroit, there are hopes that tourism can help to refuel the economy after the city was plunged into bankruptcy last year. Factory tours and museums showcase the Motor City's famous auto heritage, and if after a tour or two you're ready to switch gear, there's plenty of historic buildings and music venues too. Vintage cars line the streets of the Cuban capital, Havana, where you can also tour cigar factories and visit a rum distillery. And a trip to a disused sugar mill can also give you a real insight into this country's pre-Castro commercial heritage. And many former Soviet states now have a lot to offer if you're interested in industrial history. In the Estonian capital of Tallinn, remnants of the city's industrial past are becoming converted into cutting-edge art spaces. The neighbourhood of Kalamaja hosts a unique mixture of Soviet factories alongside wooden workers' houses right next to the seaside. You'll find industrial buildings right alongside modern architecture, perfect if you're looking for a contrast between old and new. Next up on the travel show, we're sticking with the industrial theme and heading for London's Regent's Canal. While the Thames will give you a trip through the city's history, the Regent's Canal is a more low-key waterway, dotted with houseboats and cafes. We booked ourselves an early morning ticket on one of the boats that cruise along the canal all week long, from Little Venice to Camden.
Okay, I'm going to start putting people on board. Probably, you know, 95% of the people who get on this boat each trip haven't got a clue what this is about. Next, please. I've got 45 minutes to give them as much history and what the canals are for before we get to Camden. And if I manage to do that, then I'm happy.
There you go.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Oh, thank you very much. Thank you. That's cool. And welcome aboard on this beautiful morning. Since I've been doing it, I've noticed the influx of foreign tourists and from absolutely everywhere in the world. Sometimes people ask me if I can do the commentary in German or Russian or something. And I think, we've got about 20 different nationalities on this boat. I'll do it in English. Please.
Yeah.
more than 4,000 miles or 6,000 kilometres of canals were all built by hand in a very short time. It was an amazing feat of engineering.
I mean, I live in central London. I mean, when you live alone, you live in a big city. It's a community that you can really lose very, very easily. And that's one thing we have in bucketfuls.
We're travelling at top speed. We're looking at wildlife. And we're right in the heart of London.
When you're telling people about something that you're that you love yourself and you're passionate about, what's not to like?
Well, thank you very much. I truly enjoyed it.
It's a pleasure.
Good driving. Thank you.
Time now for your travel update with Krista.
Sporting attention has shifted to Glasgow for the Commonwealth Games, but that wasn't the only thing opening in the Scottish city this week. Glasgow Tower reopened to the public after extensive refurbishments. Standing 127 metres high on the banks of the River Clyde, the tower holds the record for the tallest fully rotating freestanding structure in the world. From the viewing cabin, visitors can enjoy views of up to 20 miles across the city. More than 60 celebrities have joined the campaign to stop cruise ships from entering Venice's lagoon area. Stars from the world of arts and fashion have sent a letter to the Italian government, warning of the risks posed by ships to Venice's historic centre. Among the signatories are English actor Sir Michael Caine, American fashion designer Calvin Klein, and Australian actress Kate Blanchett. And finally, imagine this. Two kayakers off the coast of Argentina got the surprise of their lives this week when a whale lifted their boat out of the water. Argentinian officials emphasised the dangers of kayaking so close to the animals.
Still to come on the travel show.
Michelle Yana Chan has your global guide with some of the best places to visit from around the world.
That's biting.
Yeah, that's biting.
That's big bear.
Yeah, that's deep bear.
And cameras in hand, we head to northeastern Estonia on a special kind of safari.
Hello, I'm Michelle Yana-Chan, your global guide with top tips on the world's best events in the coming month. But first, in the UK, Totally Thames is taking place through the month of September from London's Isle of Dogs upstream towards Richmond. It's a 30-day programme combining regattas and races with beachcombing and acrobatics along the riverside. There'll be the Royal Greenwich Tall Ships Festival and the ethereal Handel's fireworks, music and illuminations at Hampton Court Palace. In Japan, from August 22nd to 24th, Sado Island hosts the Earth Celebration. This is when the renowned taiko drumming troupe Kodo return home after a year of touring. They'll perform three concerts in Shirayama Park with signature pieces and one-off collaborations, this year with dance and gymnastics group Blue Tokyo. Until August 19th, the Australian Surf Festival at Coffs Coast will draw the country's very best amateurs who will be fighting it out for the national longboard, logger, surf masters and single fin titles. The multi-discipline tournament will attract hundreds of competitors. From September 4th, for 4 days, the Croatian town of Pula will be hosting the Outlook Festival, celebrating bass music and sound system culture. The setting is the abandoned Fort Punta Cristo, with venues underground in the fort's tunnels and the moat. The parties continue on the beaches and off the coast too, on sailing boats. For the first time, Georgia will play host to Kazantip, also known simply as Z, an electronic dance music collective. Organisers say this is not a festival, but a republic, a meeting of creatives who, well, come here to party. You decide. Note that most people in the republic wear orange and carry a yellow suitcase. Apparently, the next event will be held on Mars.
I'm just mad about saffron.
Back in Australia, the Hello Koalas Sculpture Trail will open in September in Port Macquarie. 50 1-metre-tall fiberglass koalas, each designed by a local artist, will be posted along a trail around the Hastings River, Wauchope and Camden Haven, meandering between wineries, beaches, forests and cultural centres.
They call me Mellow Yellow.
Are you turning your head to Cornwall?
The 20th European Medieval Festival takes place in Horsens in Jutland. Set in the former state prison of Fanglesett, they'll be mingling among buskers, knights, archers and jesters, and there'll also be jousting tournaments, sword fights and axe battles. And finally, back in the UK, the Imperial War Museum in London is transforming to mark 100 years since World War I. There'll be the new First World War galleries, as well as Truth and Memory, an exhibition of British World War I art. That's my global guide this month. Let me know what's happening in the place where you live or where you love. We're on Facebook, Twitter, and email. Until next time, happy travelling.
Finally this week, we head to the swamps and forests of Estonia, which are still full of the sort of wildlife that has long since vanished in much of Western Europe. Wolves, wild boars, lynxes and flying squirrels. But now, travellers are starting to visit the country in the hope of seeing another, much larger type of animal, as Damien McGuinness has been finding out.
Almost 50% of Estonia is covered by dense woodland forests. It's a place where the great outdoors comes alive, and I'm here in search of a creature once feared by locals. The Idaviru region is where my night of brown bear watching begins. These predators are the main attraction, and just like in Finland and Sweden, bear tourism is big business.
You know, it's not that easy to find bears on your own in the forest in the middle of Estonia. So I've enlisted the help of Triin, who is a nature guide and an expert in tracking down bears. So Triin, how do we find bears in the forest?
Well, in this area, it's quite easy. You just need to find a muddy, wet, soft road. And most probably the tracks are just over there.
Well, let's go and have a look. Show me some. And so this is the paw. Claw marks are here.
Yeah.
That's biting.
Yeah, that's biting. That's
big bear.
Yeah, that's deep bear.
Bears on the lookout for honey are often attracted to poles like this, mistaking the faint buzz of electricity for a beehive.
So whoever bites highest is the toughest,
yeah,
and
yeah,
is the boss of the area.
Yeah, it's the boss of the area.
Now we've seen the marks left behind by bears, I'd quite like to see the animals themselves. So we join a group of nature lovers who are going to spend the night in the forest in the hope of seeing some bears. Tracking animals in the wild with a guide and a night in this hide costs around £80 per person.
So now we've reached the bear hide, and over there in that clearing, Triin is going to place some meat that's going to attract the bears. Right now it's 6 o'clock and I've got to go in because we're going to be in here all night till 8 o'clock the next morning. And I'm whispering because we want to be quiet. We don't really want the bears to know we're here. And once I'm in here, we're not going to leave until tomorrow morning until we've seen some bears. So now we're in the hide. It's
itself over there. You've got windows through which we'll hopefully see some bears coming to the clearing to feed. Here we've got some bunk beds where, with a bit of luck, we'll get a bit of rest later on the night once we've seen some bears.
There's an 80% chance of seeing bears, so it can take half the night before you actually see one, and sometimes you don't see any at all. So we settle ourselves in, ready for a long wait. But then suddenly, after less than an hour, we see our first bear. Wow, what an experience. A night spent out in the forest with wild animals. And what's so interesting about it is if you want to see wild animals in their natural habitats, you have no control over what you're going to see, when you're going to see it, even if you're going to see anything at all, which for us made it even more exciting, the fact that we got to see Europe's largest predator.
Well, that's all we've got time for in this edition of the programme. Coming up next week...
Hard work.
And I'm off to the beautiful Catskill Mountains north of New York City to discover if new plans can return the region to its former glory.
This area in its heyday was the place. There would be a line of cars for 10 miles long for the summer vacation. And so our hope is to put those cars back on the road, get people to come up here, and put jobs back on the map here.
Well, I hope you can join us for that if you can. And don't forget, we're all over social media and our website is definitely worth checking out too. All those details are on your screen now. But in the meantime, from me, Carmen Roberts, and the rest of the Travel Show team here in Japan, it's goodbye. We'll be right back.